In this video, I'll be covering literally everything you should know before booking a trip to Jordan. I'll start with all my top tips to get the most out of a 1 or 2 day trip to Petra, including whether it's worth booking the Petra by Night experience. We'll also cover safety whilst travelling, just how expensive or cheap travelling through Jordan can be, tips for making a trip to the Dead Sea, transport options, if it's worth purchasing the Jordan Pass, visa entry forms, and whether you should avoid visiting during the 30 days of Ramadan. For advice on what to do and see whilst in Jordan itself, please enjoy our 7 Days in Jordan vlog, which I'll link at the end. This is Suitcase Monkey on how to get the most from a trip to Jordan. So, as I'm sure you've come to expect, I'm going to go into great detail about every aspect of a holiday to Jordan, so I've marked everything out as chapters so you can find what's relevant for you. So let's start with the number one Jordan destination, which is obviously Petra. Now, since the official Petra FAQ website has no data available, I thought I'd answer all those questions here. The major sites within Petra can be seen in one day, and this is how most people choose to visit. I am glad we had the second day though, and if you're renting a car and booking everything yourself, this is how I'd do it. But most Petra tour packages you'll see will be one day, and I'll later be covering what you should focus your time on when visiting. When booking yourself, entry for one day is 50 dinar, with a 2 day entry pass costing only 5 more. Petra is also included as part of the Jordan Pass, and I'll be covering the pros and cons to getting that later. Where possible, arrive early to beat the crowds. It's obviously much more quiet in the morning, but more importantly, it's much cooler. The two major sites to visit are the Treasury and the Monastery. You'll pass the Treasury first after a 30 minute walk from the main entrance, and the Monastery is around 90 minutes later if you're making a beeline, and marks the furthest point within Petra. We reached the Monastery just before 8 a.m. Now, this moment was easily my favourite in all of the trip, so do watch our main Jordan vlog to see why. Yes, the person flying the drone slightly ruined the ambiance of it all, but it still was a magical moment. The Monastery will always be the more quiet of the two, so I can't recommend it enough. The number one view within Petra, however, is undoubtedly the Treasury from up high. There are actually two different viewpoints to get this shot, and getting to either of them isn't that straightforward, and each have their own pros and cons. There's a paid-for way, which is for those short on time, and a free way, which is for the mentally insane. I took the latter. For the paid way, you have to be taken by a guide, which you'll meet in front of the Treasury. I've read that journeys can start at 30 dinar and go down to around 10, depending on your barter skills and demand. They will then lead you up around 20 minutes of steps for the photo opportunity, and you can buy some drinks here also. All the footage you're seeing here is from the Travelling Tom YouTube channel, and I'll link this particular video in the description as it's the best one I found that shows the entire route. But although it is shorter in length than the one we took, it is more of a scramble in places with some narrow edges. This route is helped with the guide though, and is the reason that you do have to pay for one. It will be busier and there probably will be a wait at the top to take your photo, but it is quicker. The longer route, or some might say more rewarding or stupid, is to continue hiking past the Royal Tombs. This route is a lot more straightforward than the paid alternative, but you have to hike a fair distance to get to the Royal Tombs in the first place, and then it's an additional half an hour on top. I think it was extra hard for me as it came after 6 hours of already hiking up to the Monastery, and by now it was a very hot midday sun without shade, so I really struggled. So if you were going to be there for 2 days, it might be an idea to do this climb on day one and the Monastery on the next day to spread it out. There is a tent conveniently placed at the final view though, a sort of exit through the gift shop, if you will. Now, I wasn't prepared for this, so was admittedly a little bit peeved at this guy wanting money for the view that I just climbed, because I assumed that it was all just open. But now that you know in advance, it's probably the best £1 cup of tea with a sheltered view that you'll ever spend. So in summary, I'd suggest the quicker route if you're short on time and don't plan to visit the Royal Tombs, and the longer route if you have the time or don't like the look of the more narrow paths on the shortcut. So are you going to be a one day wonder or choose insanity? Let me know in the comments below. Next Now, let's talk accessibility and getting around in general. The good news is that the 30 minutes walk to the Treasury sits along the flattest part, so is easy to reach. I hadn't realised how spread out everything was, and the map that they give you lists all the possible hikes. If you're short on time, I'd simply suggest walking the main route from the entrance to the monastery and back. The monastery, as mentioned, is about 90 minutes after the Treasury, with some steady stairs in the last third, and offers amazing views before you even arrive. This route covers all the major sites and would satisfy any journey to Petra in one day. I'd then add the royal tombs, high places sacrifice, and the church in that order if you have time. I did see people riding golf buggies, which I assume you can book at the visitor center. You can also ride horses, donkeys, and camels, but personally I always feel a little bit sorry for them, so that's never an option for us. If you absolutely had to ride one, I'd suggest getting a ride back from the Treasury to the main entrance so you don't zoom past everything on your way there. Walking through the Seek at the start is a big highlight of anticipation that I wouldn't want to speed through. But for the monastery, I would say that a donkey is a no-no. We saw a lady clinging on for dear life with an energetic buckaroo donkey as it darted up these stairs, so do keep that in mind when deciding. We had a tour guide with us for day one, which I would say is almost a must, but not essential if it doesn't fit in with your overall plans. Hearing about Petra's history and small details was a decent chunk of our enjoyment though. Guides can be booked on the day from the information centre starting at 50 dinar. The other option is to book a tour package that has a guide included, and you can find a bunch of those options in the description. Jordan is a great country that caters to tour groups really well, given that locations like Jerash and Wadi Rum are all easily enhanced with a guide. And just to mention that if you do book any of the links below or hotels I'll cover next, it will support the channel and allow me to continue making these sorts of guides for your future potential travels. Oh, and before I do forget, you also always need to have your passport with you when entering Petra. One part that I totally skipped over in the main Jordan travel vlog is something called Petra by Night. Now, this is an evening experience in front of 1500 candles where you'll hear a Bedouin playing their flute, reciting some prose, offering tea. This is not included in the normal admission and is an additional 17 dinar. It only runs every Monday, Wednesday and Thursday and starts at 8:30 p.m. I'm in two minds as to whether to recommend Petra by Night or not. On the downside, you can't just stay inside Petra and wait for it to start. You have to leave and then return. After a long day, the last thing I wanted to do was the hour-long return trip to get back here. But more so, and by its own admission in the promotional leaflet, this is not a modern-day light flashy show and is a very muted affair. The good news is that Petra by Night isn't trying to be a Magic Kingdom light show and is sticking to its authentic roots, as it should. Ultimately though, the show does last 2 hours and you'll likely be fully entertained for about 15 minutes. Despite all this, I would still suggest a visit if you can. There isn't much else to do in the area that you can't do somewhere else, and it's kind of a case of, well, I'm already here, I might as well. So to sum up, if you miss it, it certainly isn't a problem and don't stress too much about rearranging your entire schedule around it. But if you do see it, keep your expectations low and then you can at least say that you saw it and tell everyone else not to bother, even though they should see it and then tell their friends not to bother. You get the point. Let's round off this Petra section with some quick fire stuff I wish I'd known before going in. Yes, there are toilets dotted around and are offered in varying degrees of being actually acceptable, but they're good enough. There are plenty of places to buy water and food. Definitely bring a hat, scarf, umbrella, etc. Whatever helps protect you from the sun, and of course, bring comfy, sturdy shoes. If you want to visit Petra as early as possible, you're probably best booking a nearby hotel. I've linked the hotel that we stayed at in the description below, along with an alternative. Ours was a 4-minute walk from the main entrance and had a nice rooftop area for drinks and relaxation. It's a relatively small town, so as long as the reviews are good and it's quick to get to the entrance, you can't really go wrong. The other hotel I linked actually overlooks Petra itself with another great looking rooftop terrace. Now, I mentioned at the start about the Jordan Pass including Petra, so let's just talk about that briefly. The Jordan Pass has to be bought online before arrival and includes entry to over 40 attractions including Petra, Jerash and Wadi Rum. It also waivers any need for a tourist visa. the Jordan Pass starts at 70 dinar, with the other two options just allowing extra days in Petra. This is a great price. The tourist visa alone costs 40 dinar, and one day in Petra is 50, so you're already saving money if you're going to visit Petra for just one day. There is actually one good reason not to buy the Jordan Pass, however, and that's if you've booked a tour package that already includes these activities. That was our situation, so we just purchased the visa on arrival at the airport and it was super easy. So if your tour doesn't include entry to Petra, definitely buy the Jordan Pass online before arrival. So now let's cover some other major attractions you'll be hitting whilst in Jordan and some useful pointers that I'll sprinkle in, such as transport and safety. For Amman, most of the general tips were covered in the main Jordan vlog, so check that out if you haven't already. The hotel we stayed in was perfectly fine, but in hindsight, I would have preferred to be somewhere much more central than we were, especially when everywhere we'd later be staying allowed us so much more space in comparison, so being in the middle of a busy city would have been welcome. I've linked a hotel in the description that has a great location to all of the most popular spots that we visited. This would have more easily allowed a siesta during the day, or even wandering around for a meal in the evening. Being on the outskirts wasn't too much of an issue though, but it's one less thing to think about, and nice to be able to stroll home at night. We did use Uber regularly in Amman, with wait times being about 5 to 10 minutes, so that would be my general suggestion for getting around the city. It only costs 4 dinar from our hotel to get into the centre for a 20 minute ride, and 17 dinar to get to the airport, which took 45 minutes. Just in case anyone mentions this in the comments, there are yellow taxis driving around Amman that you can hail as normal, and I guess is the more traditional way. We opted not to take these, as all the websites that I read laboured the point about making sure that the driver was using the meter, and not accepting stories about it being broke and having to agree on a price beforehand. So to be honest, even if that is a small minority of situations, it just shouldn't be that difficult to get a cab in 2022, so Uber it was for us. Let us know in the comments if your experience of the yellow taxis was perfectly fine, so you can just ignore what I'm saying. Public transport isn't that great in Jordan. I've read that public buses will only leave once they are full and don't run on a standard schedule that you might be used to, and passenger trains just aren't a thing. So I'd suggest taxis around Amman, renting a car, or booking guided trips or private cars for longer journeys. We did always feel safe whilst in Jordan. It's generally a very chilled country and their overall hospitality is well known. Still exercise good sense when travelling, as you would anywhere, but Jordan is one of the safest countries you can visit in the Middle East, and isn't something you should have any concern over. For the Dead Sea, if booking as part of a tour, all of the following will be taken care of, but if you are booking bespoke, I'd recommend staying in a hotel that has its own beach into the water. For one, compared to the public spaces, they're well maintained, will always have mud available, and have showers installed. The water is very oily here, so a proper rinse afterwards is really welcome. Again, the hotel we stayed in was perfectly suitable, had really nice grounds to walk around, and all the mod cons mentioned when going into the water. If you're just passing by in a car rental, it's worth pointing out that outside of hotels, the Dead Sea is only available at certain points along the highway, so it's not like a massive beach that you can just stroll along. Doing a search on Google Maps for Dead Sea free swimming brings up a few places, but with mixed reviews. The Amman tourist beach, usually the main public beach, seems to have been closed for a while now, so I just suggest driving along and keeping an eye out. If you've had an experience of this recently, again, please do help others in the comments below. I've read that the hotels also do allow you to pay for a Dead Sea day pass, which is possibly a good option to try also. The other budget option is to take a day trip from Amman, where all of this will be taken care of. Again, I've linked a few in the description, with starting prices around $60 with a hotel pickup. Some last general tips about the Dead Sea. Be aware that due to the high salt concentration, cuts, blisters, and even a recent shave will really sting, like Macaulay Culkin in the bathroom mirror sting. but I have heard that the good old Vaseline acts as a really nice barrier, so why not get your lube on and go crazy? I want to round off this guide with more general advice and tips, such as renting a car versus a tour group, visiting during Ramadan as we did, what months to travel, and how much this is all going to cost. We opted to book all of this as part of a tour group. We had a Canada trip coming up in a couple of months' time where everything was a fully bespoke road trip, so for Jordan, we just wanted something more relaxed where we didn't have to think about getting from A to B. But if I ever was to return, I would definitely rent a car and do a combination of guided tours and our own thing. In terms of the ease of driving around, outside of Oman, there are only really two roads that connect everything from the Dead Sea to Petra to Wadi Rum, so most of it would be driving on a well-maintained highway and would be relatively easy. Driving in central Oman did look like a bit of a nightmare, to be honest, so even if you wouldn't be comfortable with that, I'd just advise booking a hotel on the outskirts and getting an Uber into the center. But everywhere else, you'd be totally fine. A lot of people ask me about the benefits of doing a tour versus doing it all yourself, and to be honest, I think all of the obvious pros and cons work for each. Freedom with the car, mostly easy roads to navigate, feeling like Thelma and Louise, just without the ending, versus having a tour guide who'll fill in all the history and having most things just arranged for you. I think the good news is that Jordan is set up so that both options are totally viable. Again, I'd be interested to hear people's thoughts in the comments about where people might be leaning if they're thinking of visiting. As mentioned in the main travel vlog, we visited Jordan during Ramadan, which lasts 30 days. It means that most of the population will be fasting from dawn till dusk, and it will have a big impact on your food options during the day. All the tourist places like your hotel won't be affected, but to give you an idea, on our very first day in Oman, when we didn't quite know what we were doing yet, our first lunch ended up being in Starbucks. Wow! Which was an amazing cultural experience, as I'm sure you can imagine. It was from here that we did some Googling and found out that Rainbow Street was the best place for food, given that it caters to tourists anyway. Wadi Musa, the town next to Petra, was fine, again because it caters to tourists, and the Dead Sea and Wadi Rum were mostly hotel experiences anyway, so would have been the same whenever we visited. But ultimately, if you do have the choice, I would suggest avoiding this time of year to visit, as it will mean that all the authentic local eateries will be closed for most of the day, which will impact you at some point. The only asterisk that I'd add to that is if you happen to be visiting towards the end of Ramadan, where there's a big celebration, which would be a great thing to experience in person. It didn't ruin our holiday, obviously, so if that's the only time you're free to travel, it shouldn't be a reason not to, but we certainly missed out on some places that we wanted to visit food-wise, especially in Oman. The best times to visit Jordan are during the spring, so March to May, and autumn, September to November. In the summer, it can get crazy hot, and in the winter can see snowfall, rain showers, and incredibly cold evenings in the desert. As an FYI, English is widely spoken, even in the remote areas, and Jordan is near the top of the list for a shortage of water, so please don't waste any whilst you're in the country. It's also best to drink bottled water in general. In terms of price, Jordan is one of the more expensive countries in the Middle East. For example, a main course for an evening meal would be around $10 to $15 per person, going upwards. It's hard to give you an accurate day-to-day price for everything, as our tour included most activities and was largely half-board. The tour we took starts at $1,800 per person, including most activities and food, staying in 4-star hotels. This is definitely on the upper side, with similar tours without food being around half that. Again, I've linked a couple of different versions in the description below to check out yourself. On the budget end, after some Googling a typical spend per day for food, sightseeing, and a bed, Jordan comes to around $100 a day per person when staying in accommodation as a pair. If you found all of this useful, then please do leave a like on the video, as it really helps the channel, and let us know if these past two Jordan videos that I've done have sold you on visiting and why. Until the next one, thanks for watching, Suitcase Monkey.